gentlemen. It's good to be back.
Good to have you back.
Welcome back, Chad.
You guys did a lovely job on the show last week. I was very proud.
I almost wore that same shirt.
Did you?
Yeah.
You have the same shirt.
Yep.
Why didn't we wear the same shirts in Las Vegas or at the card show?
We should have. Matching shirts.
Well, I partially remedied that. And Ricky, we did not plan this. Maybe you did, but that was a perfect segue.
No.
Ricky, you did not get one yet, but yours is coming.
Okay.
It's because you ghosted Tim and I for this past week in the text message column.
Mm-hmm.
Tim has his, our spiffy new
Ooh.
Back to the Future trucker hats.
Those. Designed by Chaz.
Mm-hmm.
Those are.
You can wear them backwards, flat brim. You can keep the tag on, wear your chains around them.
That's pretty sharp looking.
It is sharp.
Actually, it looks pretty good.
Right? Yeah, it does look good.
Are you going to wear that to the National?
Well, yeah, I bought them a couple months ago when the three amigos were going to go to the National.
You can carry
in
around
2022, that. The three amigos will wear the Pack to the Future hats.
In the meantime,
Atlantic
we could,
City, baby.
We could like get you like a fanny pack around your belly and have like an iPad and you could like FaceTime Tim and I. And we could
you
be like the walking three amigos.
I would. Oh, I am so down for that. Honestly, I have some gimmicks lined up for this show, and that would be really funny. Oh my God, that would be funny.
Just don't cut a window in your pants like you did that little baggy poster on Instagram.
There's an Adam. Oh, it's 101.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Pack to the Future. I'm your host, Ricky, a.k.a. Mr. eBay. And I am joined by my co-host and partner in crime, Dr. Chad.
Someone called for a doctor?
How you doing, Doc?
I'm good, buddy.
And we're joined, as always. He doesn't have a collar on. He can't win to save his life, ladies and gentlemen. Dr. Tim!
Here we go, baby. Prepare to be underwhelmed.
Well, this week, we are going to talk about National Treasure screwing the people over. We've got some grading issues, and we've got some selling issues. But more importantly, we've got some Tim issues.
We have some big-time Tim issues. We've tried to avoid this topic on the show for the last little bit, but this is unavoidable.
Tim, I never did get from you. You literally inspired an entire segment on this week's show.
With the
National Treasure card you sold, and we talked about it a little bit last week. You said you didn't want to talk about it. I honored your wishes. This week, there will be no such honoring. Tell us what you sold, and tell us what you sold it for. I just want to give an example of how bad your luck is.
Yeah. So you're referencing the Donovan Mitchell 2017 National Treasures true RPA out of 99.
Yeah.
Of which originally there were only redemptions for, and you could take the gamble on those sight unseen for about $4,500. And I did twice.
You had two?
Wait, yeah. Is that what you're saying? Oh,
this wasn't supposed to be a fight segment, but we're escalating this quickly.
I know that's a beer foul of some kind. And so you wait a couple months after buying these, scratching off the codes and sending them in, and they went live pretty quickly, which was pretty cool.
Yeah.
And I dumped one of them because it was not really a two-color patch. They only had the gold and the navy, two-tone patches. And the second one only had like a 10% sliver of blue aside from the gold. So that one got jettisoned, had a worse auto. And then the one I kept was pretty well centered. Nice auto, nice patch. Fast forward, back when I did not know what I was doing grading, and I still might not know, but back then I really didn't know.
Yeah,
and I
criticized the crap out of this.
No, nobody knows. But I criticized the crap out of
Tim, hold on. People know. I just need you to know. People know. You don't yeah. know.
I just got a sub back today with 50% PSA 10s. The other 50 were 9, so I was pretty happy with that.
Yeah, people know nice, Tim. Nice, yeah. And I posted on Instagram, too, on our story about the joke about sending in a pristine card and getting back a 6. So with a little Thanos snap of the fingers.
So tell us about your terrible luck.
Yeah, I critiqued about, you know, that... Anyway, that RPA critiqued the heck out of it, and I thought the centering was bad. I sold it to a guy for... $4,500, basically just got my money back. And he promptly sent it to BGS back when they were still getting things back in a timely manner. And he shoved the result right in my face and he's like, ha, BGS 9.5, baby.
Congratulations, Ross Berman.
So
I'm sure.
Damn it, Ross.
At some by now.
No, but yeah, and at that point, it was worth about $8,000. Fast forward to this year, and it's upward of about $19,000, $20,000 as a true gem.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Chaz does not approve of your early sale.
As I mentioned last week, you are the walking rain cloud.
I am the worst.
But that's only one of many, many instances that we have to cover here, Tim. You have escalated your terrible luck. Really just exponentially over the past couple of weeks, but in the world of sports betting, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Tell us about some of these terrible beats that you've had.
Should we go in chronological order or just in the order that I told you guys about them?
What do you think, Ricky? Least worst to most awful?
Yeah.
Least worst to most awful.
And then tell us before you go most awful. I've got a drum roll. Okay. We've got to start using these elements.
Okay. I'll just go in chronological order because that kind of matches up anyway. So
no, you just asked us and we told you.
Yeah, you.
No, I said it just matches you up. Literally,
he knows better than you, ladies.
No, fine, whatever. No, it actually goes in order anyway.
Okay.
So,
June I believe 3rd. That because he got angrier and angrier and bet more and more is what I believe.
Yeah, and you just had awful beats and that's what spurred this.
Yeah. Well, there's lots of different methodologies to recouping losses, but I don't know that I was intentionally doing that or trying to or not.
Sure.
June 3rd, it's a Thursday, coasting pretty high because I've been having a pretty darn good week. For me, that was up $3,140 when I checked my balance.
Okay.
The betting weeks are Sundays to Sunday, so Thursday being up is generally a pretty good sign because you're over the hump and you're coasting into the weekend. Nuggets Blazers, game 6. This is the game after Damian Lillard went completely nuts in, what was it, triple OT for 55 points.
That feels like a lifetime ago.
Doesn't it, though? Yeah. I mean, just these playoffs are dragging. But anyway, the next game, I bet the over for the points in the second half. After they had scored 70, so they really didn't show any signs of fatigue. They were still shooting lights out. And so
you made a bet on the second half of a game over under.
Uh-huh. Yeah, exactly. Because okay. You can kind of get a feel for a game after watching the first half. And okay. So usually it's a little bit more intuitive to guess on the second half. And so after 70 points combined in the third quarter, I had the over at 112.5 points. So they had to score at least 113 for my bet to cash. And so they didn't need much, 43 points combined. Right. Lillard, off his hot shooting game, finally poops out and he goes 1 for 4 for the quarter. And the Blazers scored how many points that quarter? 14. What did the total for the half end at? 112.
Oh. Oh.
Ouch.
No.
But whatever, I move on because I'm still doing well for the week. Half point losses are no big deal. They're actually fairly common in the world of sports betting, and that's why those stupid half points matter.
Is that what your sports bookie keeps telling you?
That's what I keep telling myself and what fellow sports bettors commiserate with. But June 19th, trying to turn the ship around. I kind of dialed it back, only put $80 on a parlay. This was an $80 parlay to win about $1,000. I'm on the last leg, so the last pick of a 4-pick parlay. Watching some baseball, you know, I'm kind of half-heartedly looking at my phone and trying to minimize expectations. But the Orioles, which Chad kind of questioned me about because they are one of the worst teams in the major leagues right now.
Like, what made you wake up
relegated last year?
Yeah, what made you wake up that morning and say, like, yeah, you know, I think I'm going to bet on the Orioles today?
There was some thought to this. I mean, it's the law of averages, right? The Orioles had lost.
Tim, the law of averages have never applied to you in your entire life. We did a whole segment on Fatal Four Ways where you literally fell into fourth place almost every time. You're taking logic and applying it to the one person on this planet that logic does not apply to.
Damn it.
Oh my gosh.
All right, continue.
Orioles had lost 21 games straight on the road at that point, I think. It was some absurd number.
So the Orioles and Timmy were due.
It was their first game back home, I think. And I was like, well, they can't play any worse than they played on the road at home. And I was right. I was right for 8 innings of this game. They were winning 7-4 going into the top of the ninth. So they're playing at home. Top of the ninth rolls around. They're 98.7% favorites going into the top of the ninth. I'm counting my money on this parlay already. I was like, hey, $1,000 off of $80. Not bad. I actually went to my phone and I pushed a little green check mark next to the parlay. I was like, I'm cashing this.
Why? Okay.
15 minutes later, I go back and I check, you know, it's about bedtime right now. And I roll over and I look and I'm like, what in the but how many runs did the Blue Jays score in the top of the ninth? Like one or two would have been acceptable. They hung a 6 spot in the top of the ninth to win 10-7.
That was that night that I was awakened by both Twitter and Apple News feeds blowing up my phone. Pitcher brings gas can to Baltimore. Lights city on fire. And sure enough,
so bad. So bad.
Yeah. So that was bad, but there's more.
It gets worse, guys. It gets worse. Hey, you remember when I was talking up Mbappe at the Dallas Card Show in March? I was super jazzed, and off the heels of a lot of hype, Mbappe cards went from $1,100 to $580 on June 27th.
I'll be honest. The only reason I know Mbappe is because of you. And you have been shoving it down our throat. He's probably the only soccer player that's like a superstar right now that I know.
Uh-huh. Does that sound like a superstar's card values to you? This is a 2018 Prism World Cup PSA 10 that I'm referencing, by the way.
So yes. Ricky, as your eBay status has been in question on the Instagram world, I would advise you not to answer that question.
Oh, I'm not touching soccer for the 10-foot pole.
Good.
Stay away, people, especially any card I bought. But this is relevant because on June 28th, France versus Switzerland in the ongoing European Championship knockout round seemed like a pretty safe bet to take France, heavily favored, return champions. $100, that's all. Took a little 5-pick parlay to win about $1,500 if it was to cash. Still early in the day.
Let's pause. Wait, is this number one?
This was the worst beat of the three that I told you guys about.
I imagine Tim walking in like Vince McMahon walking down the aisle with his stacks of cash. Heavily
no chance.
France, huh? Mm-hmm. See about that.
No chance.
Had a little confidence going into this. You know, there's no way little Switzerland was going to lose to France. Got my Mbappe card sitting on my lap. Super excited. This is leg two, pick number two, because it's still early in the morning because of these games airing in the morning over here. France, minus half a goal. They just had to win. Win by a goal in regulation. So I don't know if you guys were watching this game or not.
I fell asleep during the end.
During the end, right? Because you're like, oh, okay, France, you know, soccer. They finally went up 3-1.
Right.
A little after halftime and, soccer is boring. They kick the ball back and forth and you're expecting a 2-goal lead to to hold up generally.
Especially from one of the best countries of in the world at soccer.
Oh, absolutely. And so I looked away from the TV. I went and I did something else. I pick up my phone with about 85 minutes left, or 85 minutes into the match.
Is this the sound your phone made?
You went to Facebook is where you went. That's where you were on Facebook documenting this up. This is a lock. That's where you stepped away from.
No. So I pick my phone back up. I look at the score. I'm on a little bit of a lag because at this point I'm on vacation with my parents in California and I have kind of crappy cell reception, right? So we're driving on our way to lunch and I pick my phone back up. And, you know, the score, I was like, oh, okay, well, it's 3-2 at this point. That sucks. And so I messaged my friends who were watching the soccer game on Facebook Messenger. And I was like, WTF, France. FFS, for F's sake.
And then what was France like?
What do you mean?
He's just busting your butt. He's just busting your balls.
Just talking to you the way I talk to my 10-year-old son who talks like that. WTF, France.
The story gets better, though. So they didn't know I was on a lag. And they're like, yeah, exactly. I go to update my phone again. I click refresh because I'm like, well, are they talking about the same thing? I don't know, because I kind of knew I was a lag at that point. And the score flashes across 3-3, 90th minute. I'm like, no! No!
Just imagine him starting to curse in the car. His parents have no clue why.
No.
The Purge music starts playing. He starts shutting all his blinds.
Everyone walks out of their house and just stares and points at Tim. Blank face.
What have I done? What did I do?
But there's still a chance for you to win.
There still is.
No, because the bets are in regulation. So at 90 minutes, that's all that matters because they don't want to factor in the overtimes or the penalty kicks. And I dug a little deeper because I was like, so when did this match get tied? Because I had already checked the score at 85 minutes. And the tying goal was scored in the 90th minute. Like, do you guys realize that's the soccer equivalent of like a 0.1 second buzzer beating shot?
Yeah. But at least after all that money you lost, you still had your Mbappe card. And he was going to come be the savior of the day, and that value was going to go up, up, up until Timmy could sell it.
Yeah, Sully. What kind of soccer advice was that? Pretty sure I heard you right. You said it was going to double by the Euros. You didn't mean that it was going to tank by half.
Well, no, but I think, but he won the day and it has probably increased substantially, right?
No.
What happened, Tim?
I already told you earlier. It dropped to like $580, $600-ish.
Yep.
Rounding up generously.
And then it goes to overtime and Mbappe missed the game losing kick.
Yeah. Best striker on France's side. Manages to blow the penalty kick.
How much is your card worth now?
I don't know. I haven't checked. Don't remind me.
So all of this got us thinking. Tim, Ricky and I, as you know, we are world-renowned ghost hunters.
Yeah.
We have traveled the Earth to the scariest places on Earth. Ricky, this man is cursed. There's no other way to explain it. He is cursed.
Right.
And so we're going to do a little something right now. We've got Mrs. Doc here. We're going to have her do a little tarot reading for you live on the air, Timmy. We think that you need it. So let me extend this microphone here. Let's see. Mrs. Doc, can you lean into this?
Hi.
Hi, Mrs. Doc.
All right. So she's got the tarot cards laid out in front of her. Go ahead. And what we want to know is, what do I need to know about Tim's gambling?
Okay, I'm going to do a 5-card illumination and clarity spread.
I don't know what that means, but she has cards and she's shuffling.
I like the sound of cards.
We've got Tim. Tim, no. You have to be invested in this, Tim.
We've got
to
get this ghost out of you.
come like on,
with,
man.
With tarot cards, are there like tarot cards? Are there, is there like a three card flop? And then like, do I get to hold two?
No, Tim. Okay, I'm going to put a microphone or an earpiece in her ear. Here we go. Go ahead.
Okay, so the first card is the Fool.
You're such an idiot, Tim.
Okay. But the Fool means that it's a person that takes risks, is impulsive and wild, and does not plan or have careful analysis of the situation.
Doesn't sound like me at all. Come on, guys.
I think the specific question is about gambling, so maybe it's just
it's what actually gambling pretty does accurate. To you.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then the next card is the Two of Hearts, and hearts always mean emotion. So I think there's a lot of emotion in this impulsivity and the gambling.
This is getting scary.
Did
you shuffle? Are you sure you shuffled? Yeah.
I did watch her.
You dealing from the bottom.
Uh-huh. She's dealing from the bottom. Yeah.
Tim, not everything's a conspiracy. It's just you've had some bad luck, man. You got a demon. This is what we're telling you.
Come on. Which car is bent right now? Where's the bent corner?
I would never bend these cards. They're very important to me. Okay, so then we have the Swords, and it's the King of Swords. That means obsession, obsessive thoughts, fears, and paranoia. So I think that maybe this
I like where this is going.
Keeps you up at night a little bit, maybe.
Maybe.
It's and quite then, possible.
Two more cards here.
Two more?
Oh, jeez. Yeah. It's a five card spread.
I know, you told me that.
I did a quick one.
I know, you're just cutting like him right to his soul right now. And this is literally a lashing to the soul for Tim.
Okay. we have the Prince of Wands.
Dad's angled the camera towards the desk so that I know that this isn't scripted
by us.
Wait. The Prince of Wands. This is the wrong show for that.
Okay. So that usually means that you've lost motivation or you're depressed about something.
I texted you guys that recently.
Mm-hmm.
No. Yeah. Okay, and then the Pentacles is the last card. And that usually has to do... Sorry, I'm not getting close enough to the mic. Okay, the Pentacles is the last
Watch
card.
It.
It's the Three of Pentacles.
This is a family show.
So like testicles and
pentacles.
Well, thanks, Tim, for coming right out and saying
it. Honey, again, this...
Tentacles.
That card's for later.
Pentacles.
And pentacles, like stars. Like stars.
Like stars. Oh, I know. I gotcha.
Okay. So that it's a low number. So it usually means the pentacles have to do with money problems or failure. And the low number, that means that... you're losing money or you're losing, large amounts.
So. That's all
losing
pretty accurate.
Large amounts on halftime bets in sports.
Yeah.
Based on the card with the Fool and then the separate suits that we pulled, I'm betting that you have some type of curse.
That with betting's, yeah. Convenient
so,
word to use.
Tim, earlier today, we did think you were cursed. Mrs. Doc and I did prepare a box for you at your house. Do you have that box?
Yeah. I mean, this is coming as no surprise, right? Like, you guys know I do have a decent amount of self-awareness, and that's actually pretty freaky far as how accurate that was.
Right?
Yep. Which is how this goes, which is why it's terrifying and why I don't generally...
So we want to do a cleanse, Tim, an honest to goodness cleanse. Yeah. Mrs. Doc had supplied some cleansing materials there. You've got them. We want you to light it. Okay. And as we go into break, we want you to recite that poem that comes with it to get rid of your curse.
I'm opening the box now. It's a nice little pamphlet that says Mama Wonderbar. Today's episode, with a bowl that I'm not supposed to smoke, but light on fire.
Are you going to smoke it?
You don't smoke. No. Tim, you're doing everything to not get rid of the curse. You don't.
Oh, I know.
You have to smoke it, first of all.
I'm trying.
And was this sage?
Yeah, it's sage, right? Yeah. As far as I can tell.
It's a smudging stick.
Smudging stick, yep.
And it's not going to work unless you take some massive rips off that bad boy.
It's by the end what of I was the asking you about. Like,
but he's got rid of his curse.
By God, he's green and a monster and dead.
You know, one of my friends who's Buddhist, he was like, you need to get your butt to a temple.
So Tim has lit it. We can see smoke.
Mm-hmm.
Tim, lead us into break by reciting that poem there, and let's get rid of this curse.
Sounds like a plan. All right. Just reading from the top?
From the top, my man.
All right. Cleanse the space. Remove the past. Fill this place with joy and love. Negative energy may not stay. I release it.
Hey there, Pac-Maniacs. Have you ever thought to yourself, boy, I wish I was on the winning end of one of Tim's team's disastrous late-game meltdowns? Have you ever wanted to send Ricky countless text messages regarding a fantasy trade, only to have him never return or ever call you back? Or even better, do you want to listen to me give you countless excuses as to why Drew Locke threw that last interception? Well, if so, the Pack to the Future Fantasy Football League is right for you. Details are coming soon.
All right, everyone, welcome back to the show. You can check us out on our Instagram at Pack to the Future Podcast or search for us on YouTube. Guys, at the end of last week's show, I talked to Timmy, and we kind of started the show this week about your Donovan Mitchell RPA, National Treasures, that you sold. And let me ask you guys first a couple of questions. You guys each have a few relic or patch cards, correct?
Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Do you have any minimum requirements for relics or patches that you collect?
No. Go ahead, Tim.
No, go ahead.
I don't buy. Yeah, I guess I do. Usually it's got to be an RPA. Okay. Because I'm trying to minimize the bulk cards that I have, and I don't want just a little napkin patch.
Okay. So so you're going after rookies.
Usually, yep. Usually rookies, okay. Or just a ridiculous patch. I have a couple of Rudy Gobert's that are just, dude, patches of the logo or something there. So either an RPA, which is nicer, or some type of patch that has a logo in it.
Okay. What about you, Timmy?
For me, it's the colors, and if it's not game worn or game used, no thanks.
Yeah. I'm similar to Tim that way. Or I like to think I am. I think we all have some patches that like we'll let slide because it's our favorite player or something, but
Nico.
Yeah. Well, that's kind of where I'm going here. And I'll tell you through this process, we've seen a number of different ways that they can list it, right? Which is the bottom, which is enclosed material not associated with any specific player, game, or event. Then you've got player worn / used. You've got event used, or game worn. And I want to just have a little bit of a discussion about that while talking about National Treasures specifically. With National Treasures, it's a product that comes out at the end of the year or towards the end of the year by comparison, towards the end of the season, if I'm not mistaken. Is that right, Timmy?
National Treasures?
Correct.
Yeah. And then Flawless usually after the end of the season because they have to wait for the actual in-season patches generally.
Well, you just stepped all over my point, Timmy, because that is the big problem with National Treasures, in my opinion. I think that National Treasures is the most sought-after product, even above Flawless. Would you both agree with that statement?
Yeah.
Yes. That's like the standard for RPAs.
Yeah, right. So I did some research on this, and what got me started really was my Nico Mannion, and it was actually a Flawless. Stick with us here because this might get a little confusing. My Flawless Nico Mannion at the University of Arizona came back and said it was a player worn / used card. And I have it on good authority, very good authority, that get player used or worn, it means jerseys get shipped to their home and they get paid to put on one after the other. I think that's a total rip. I think that's completely an abomination to what the idea of patches were in the first place, which is a piece of history, a piece of something that this player wore while playing my favorite sport or for my favorite team, what have you.
That's a completely ridiculous expectation, Ricky.
Do you think that because of the product, Ricky, that it's flawless, or because it's misleading by looking at the card?
Flawless and National Treasure are also your typical most expensive products.
Mm-hmm.
I think the fact that they are the most expensive and that they are coming out at the end of the season, I think is done intentionally to try and make some collectors believe that, oh, we're waiting on the actual patches from these games.
I see.
And for the prices you're paying, I think it's ironic that in some of the lower end products, you're getting game worn. Absolute, our one of our old favorites, is really good with game worn. And a couple lower end products. And I think that it's a travesty that National Treasures gets all this hype as the best when it doesn't have an actual game worn jersey. I wanted to go in and kind of illustrate this point a little bit more. So I did some research and I looked up a couple basketball players. The Giannis Antetokounmpo had a National Treasure RPA sell in September of 2020. It was a 1/1 logo man. And it was a BGS grade 9 with a 10 auto. It sold for over $1.8 million. That jersey was event worn.
Event?
Event worn. What do you think, Chad? What do you think that means, event worn?
That makes me think. So I don't know. This is pure speculation.
Sure. That's what this is meant for.
Off the top of my head, it would make me think at like a card show or at a meet the team. Yeah. Event?
Yes.
Or like a community event where for some reason, maybe a basketball camp?
So National Treasures, I do have a college football patch, right? And I'm thinking pep rally. I think, it's easier to illustrate what you're trying to say, right? Pep rally. What about you, Timmy? What do you think it might be?
Event warm. Honestly, I mean, it could be like the day after his draft, right? Like he could have gone on a little meet and greet around the stadium and been like, hey, I'm wearing a Bucks jersey. Like, maybe that's giving it a little.
Another one I've heard.
Exactly, right? That's maybe too generous, though. I don't know.
Well, one I've heard online is photo shoot. That's an event for some of these cards. Mm-hmm. You know, some of these cards only do the photo shoots. I just think that is such a ripoff when you're spending $1.2 million for an event worn jersey. Another illustration in January 2021, National Treasure RPA of Steph Curry. This one was out of 25, BGS grade 9.5 with a grit auto of 10, sold for $948,000. The Zion Williamson in June 2020, National Treasure RPA at a 99, ungraded, sold for $100,000. Both of those jerseys were player worn or used. The jersey was shipped to him, put on for a moment, and taken off. The flawless, on the other hand, as you kind of hinted at, Timmy, was the Zion is game worn. But there is currently a Zion / Jaw 1/1 dual logo man, National Treasures. And I do think that this is their online version that they also made a card for. Blockchain.
Because they had released a physical card back then with their blockchain, which they don't do anymore.
All of those player worn or used, not even event. And then I went on to go beyond National Treasures, and I'll dump this last piece of info, then we'll have a little chat about it. Even the Michael Jordan card, or excuse me, not Michael Jordan, LeBron James, was in June 2020, his Upper Deck RPA at a 23 sold for, it was a BGS 9.5 and auto 10, sold for $1.8 million. And then in April 2021, sold for the same card, $5.2
million. Yeah.
That one spelled out that he only wore that at a photo shoot.
Oh, it specifically said that?
It said that specifically on the back of the Upper Deck card.
Okay.
So why do you guys think, why do you either of you feel that there isn't more outrage over this? Do we really even care about RPAs? Is it just extra decoration to you guys, to the collectors on average? What do you guys think as to why National Treasure is still more in demand when you have a flawless product in the professional sports leagues are giving you game worn?
Your first question was like, does it actually improve the aesthetics of a card? And is that why we like them?
Well, just what's the purpose of chasing an RPA to either of you? Why the P? Why not chase an RA, an auto only? Yeah, is it because what does this piece of jersey serve for you? Is it decoration? Is it like an auto? To me, it's like an auto. And I'm curious what you guys think.
I think for an RPA specifically, like if you're documenting that this rookie played in this year and that the card is something he signed in that year, you would want the jersey to also be something he wore that year, right? Or the player, sorry, not just he. Sure. Right. So I think it would be reasonable to expect that that jersey was worn, preferably for a game, right? I think that is the value of Flawless, is that they wait so long because they actually want the player to have worn this memorabilia item.
Right.
But now it's become not even just game worn. It's very much leaning towards the fact that it's event worn or player worn. But that surprises me about the LeBron, the Jordan, the Curry, the Giannis, right? Like I would have expected cards from those eras or those years to be a higher likelihood of actually being game worn.
Right. Right?
I would have expected that to be part of the value, which is actually pretty impressive then that these cards have sold for that much, right? Because then who knows what the value would be if they were actually game worn. I mean, like a game worn piece of a Jordan rookie. I mean,
can you imagine?
Or LeBron, or yeah, even Curry, right?
Yeah.
Wow.
What about you, Chad?
Yeah, Chad.
What is the purpose of an RPA?
Well, I think the traditional sense that we think of is the RPA, as you both mentioned, should have a piece of a game worn jersey. And I think that we as collectors potentially contribute to the problem that Panini can put in player worn, yet we still call it an RPA.
Right.
I mean, at the beginning of this segment, I told you RPAs is what I collect or what I look for in a patch. But even the one that I just purchased this week of Drew Locke is player worn. Yet I still called it to you in the commercial break,
right,
an RPA. And perhaps we're all doing ourselves a disservice by lumping that in. I mean, we're giving Panini or whoever's making the cards in whatever sport, we're giving them the benefit of the doubt by still calling these cards RPAs, even though they are not truly giving us the product of maybe what we're thinking is an RPA.
Well, and to build on that, Chad, you know, we do a lot of shtick where Chad will banter with Tim and I, mainly me, but Tim also, about how bad baseball sucks. Cards.
Yeah, it does.
But I'm telling you, I do find myself wondering why I'm going back to baseball repeatedly when my team is terrible. And it's my least favorite of the three to watch. And part of it is because they're the more affordable card. But part of it is they do a complete, as bad of a job as Panini does with theirs, patches, I think Topps does that good of a job with theirs. The overwhelming majority are game worn. They're the only sport league that will put those stickers on that will tell you which game specifically that jersey came from, that I've seen anyway. I really think that they do a good job with it. And I think that I think you're right, Chad. I think we've allowed Panini, we've said, hey, National Treasure, vertical RPA, that's the classic. And we just forgive them for all the rest.
Let's brand it right now. Back to the Future podcast. These are not RPAs if they're not truly game worn. Yep. They are RPWAs, player worn.
Yes.
Rookie player worn, player worn autographs.
Well, and you know, we could dive into the whole thing of what do you think like game worn versus game used means? We got into that a little bit last week with my cousin and
right.
Of like, I didn't even think about that could be a shoot around shirt. Or jersey. It could be warm-ups. I think that the message I want to get out there is you should not trust Panini or any of the card companies at all, and you should read the back of that card, and whatever that wording says, assume the lowest common denominator. Because they, trust me, they want to advertise. If it's game used, they're going to be flashing that baby all over the place. Trust me, they're going to use the most advantageous language. So
go trademark RPWA for us, Ricky.
Done.
This Tim. Is our way out of work.
Yes. Tim, file it next to junkies.
Done.
Get your tax guy on it.
These are good points, Ricky. I like it. Some good deep thinking for our listeners. Well, it's not all comedy here. Man, gotta think a little bit.
Yeah, I'm just saying, Timmy. Like, I think that there might be some pretty cool RPAs out there that are not National Treasure of Donovan. Not a ton, but maybe that are actually game used.
Ross has them.
I'm pretty sure Ross has purchased like a key to Donovan's home at this point.
Okay. On Instagram today, I'll try and make this short.
Yeah.
Kyle and Wax Museum posted a podcast this week where he brought on vintage Pacers cards, I think is his handle. Anyway, they talked about how the two of them will collaborate on which Pacer cards that they want to buy so that they're not driving up price, and they share them and they're best friends. And, you know, they go running on the beach together and they kind of frolic and it's all good. And they share cards and it's great. And all I could think to myself is every Donovan Mitchell collector out there is like facing Ross, who's the nicest guy in the world, which makes it even worse, in like Mortal Kombat. And he just has flawless victories every time with like the worst brutalities against all of us trying to bid against his cards.
Mm-hmm. Spinal cord ripped out, heart ripped out, arms ripped off so he can't bid on eBay.
And he owns all the cards, which are great. And it just makes it so hard because he's such a nice guy. But it made me think about that. So with Donovan Mitchell, yeah, it doesn't matter. He owns it.
Just don't buy golds because we can't afford them. And so those are the ones that you really have to fight Ross for. So stay away.
All right. Well, when we come back, PayPal is screwing people over. And I don't know what to say about our grading companies. We'll be right back after this.
Hey there, Jimmy.
JCK O'Houlihan.
That's right, son. I'm here to tell you about Card Ladder. If you like collecting, investing, tracking your cards, then Card Ladder's right for you.
Gee, Mr. O'Houlihan, I can't wait.
Just remember, Jimmy, the four C's of Card Ladder. Cards, collection, compare, and cards. Go to the link in the show notes. Check out the Pack to the Future link to start your 7-day free trial today.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the show. Ricky, Tim, I'm excited for this third segment because Tim decided to put his last couple of days into breaking Instagram and the internet. And I think he successfully accomplished this with some news stories here. Tim, the HGA video we're going to touch on here in just a moment. Oh, I could not. I've got some feelings about it. But we got a few things that we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about PayPal, HGA. I have my SNC card return that we talked about with my VMAX Jesus Shuttlesworth that I sent in a couple weeks ago. And then we got some news from PSA as well. So, Tim, let's start with the PayPal. Ricky and I, we're kind of wrestling guys. So just like the
Montreal.
Ricky, what was the one that Bret the Hitman Hart got screwed on? The Montreal screw job?
Montreal.
We're going to call this one the PayPal screw job. So, okay. Tim, why don't you tell us about PayPal?
Yeah. Every now and then, you know, these companies update you, right? Usually it's the boring terms of service update, you know, delete. And PayPal did send one that was like, you know, hey, updating your account and how it's going to be used. Like, well, that sounds different. Maybe my account got suspended again. So I pull up this email and it's attached to a photograph that says, hey, we've updated the fee structure. You know, you're looking through, looks harmless enough. You know, you have to dig into it, settle into it a little bit, and figure out what they're actually trying to tell you. And the first row looks great. It says, currently, your online credit and debit card payments without chargeback protection, your fee is 2.9%, which we're all familiar with. The plus 30 cents, you know, people don't like doing math, but that's been standard. I think a lot of people know that. So it's basically the 3% fee that PayPal's always done. So it noticeably dropped from 2.9 to 2.59%. I was like, oh, That's a win. That actually went down. What a pleasant surprise. I'm about to give them a little pat on the back like eBay has been doing lately, giving us some better terms of service for the seller. But no, they blew it in a heartbeat by extending the next line to say plus 49 cents instead of 30 cents. So while that might not seem like a whole lot, the large majority of eBay purchases probably fall under the range of $5, at least for the hobby. You know, in terms of sheer volume, there's tons of cars being sold in the $1 to $5 range. So that's a 50% increase on that 30 cent fee, transaction fee, basically. So even though the overall percentage goes down, that's already a loss. That's gone up to 49 cents.
And you're speculating on the numbers of volume of cards from $1 to $5, just for the record.
Yeah.
I think
yeah.
you're right, but this is speculation.
Yeah, speculation. So I wish I had some data on that, but I don't. But it's a hunch, and you guys know I like my conspiracies. So
don't we
The next row gets a little meatier. The online credit and debit card payments with chargeback protection.
Can you explain the difference to me?
Next to it.
Like, what card in this world does not have chargeback protection?
Well, no. So all of our cards, even debit cards now, do have that built in. Right. So that's another sneaky way that PayPal is trying to pull one over on us, because they're offering the privilege of chargeback protection above and beyond what your credit card and debit cards already provide. But as a seller, if you wanted that peace of mind via PayPal directly, currently it's that 2.9% plus 30 cent structure. But with the updated terms of service coming August 2nd, 2021, it is now 2.99%. So a sneaky little bump there, plus the increase from 30 cents to 49 cents. So 2.99% plus 49 cents per transaction. And that's something you have to opt into as a seller.
What do you mean?
So you're a seller and you want that protection against your buyer, potentially 30 days later, clicking the little chargeback button or filing a claim through their card provider saying, hey, this was a fraudulent purchase or an erroneous purchase, or my card got lost, quote unquote lost, and somebody bought it. And so as a seller, you want that protection for a marginally increased fee.
So the chargeback protection is referring to eBay's chargeback protection.
eBay or you, no. So this is you as the end payer. Well, right. Yeah. So you as an eBay seller.
So I get to select which option I want to go.
Correct.
With. Okay.
You as a seller, whether that's on PayPal, on eBay, on whatever forum or merchant site.
But tell them the real kick in the nuts.
Yeah. So not only that, but you know, this the chargeback protection, like most people are going to opt into that reasonably, right? Because you know, it's like the trip insurance, right? Like I just booked a flight and was like, oh, for $13 in case of any unforeseen circumstances, you can have, you know, trip insurance. It's going to be the same thing. They're going to make gobs and gobs and gobs of money off of just that little tiny little bump in fee because people are going to want it for peace of mind. The next kick, though, this is what really got me fired up. I was like, oh, okay, you know, I can kind of understand that this is a pretty normal standard fee bump. But the third row, PayPal digital payments. Like, huh, PayPal is a digital payment processor. Currently, their fees are in line with their standard fee across the board, which is the 2.9% plus 30 cents. And this number bump got me a little bit just angry. 3.49%. That's just a really obvious bump from 2 to 3. You know, that you can't play the whole like grocery 2.99 trick. They just went straight over. They went 3.49% plus the 49 cent fee. So you're thinking about this. Well, okay, you know, so you're already prepping for the fee bump, right? Because that's already what they were doing the first two rows. And then this one, they jacked it all the way up. And you had to think about this one. Because again, PayPal is a digital payment processor. And they're saying that their own digital payments are going to cost them more money, or that they're going to charge you more money to use their own payment system that costs them nothing to funnel money back and forth between accounts. They're going to charge you more.
It's absurd.
Think about that. Think about that. And then on top of that, so I dug into this a little bit more. Digital payments also includes PayPal Pay Later. PayPal Pay Later is basically like a installment plan or like a credit line.
Oh, I've seen that where it says like you can own this Donovan Mitchell RPA for $46 for 24 months.
Exactly. That if that were an option from a guy named Tim selling one.
Right.
But they're making interest off of that too, right? Like they're making money off of their own payments, making money off of their own payment credit lines. I mean, they're making gobs and gobs and gobs and gobs of money per transaction. And on top of that, fees on top of transaction fees on top of interest payments.
That's insane. Greed. And
it is.
And you posted on it, on our Instagram for our listeners to see those numbers. And while we're at it, I'll just note, Stephen in Massachusetts. Yeah, we know where you are, and you commented what you thought was a funny joke. You're right. Mr. eBay doesn't know the fee structure. I'm so far up in my ivory tower that I wouldn't know 2.99 from 3.49 if it hit me in the ass. But the real funny one was from Wax Museum Podcast. There are two guys that could have posted this. This post screams, Tim.
Well, it shouldn't be hard, right? Because on the internet, I'm always teetering between the edge of like, you know, fired up and troll. So like somewhere in that little limited range is my tone of voice when I'm posting about something.
And we all know I can't read, so I wouldn't have read that email anyway. So that narrowed it down to you pretty quick, Tim. So that was a good one.
I don't even want to use PayPal or Venmo anymore. Like they are really they're like Panini. They are trying to lose our business. I swear it.
No, but they know that we don't use other services, right? Like Cash App exists, Zelle exists,
right?
Crypto exists. There's Apple Pay. There's Facebook Pay. I mean, they all have their trade-offs, but there are other options. But for whatever reason, the hobby community just hates not using PayPal. I mean, like PayPal has a stranglehold on so many different transaction types, like merchants. It's already like embedded in their, their checkout system. Like it just, PayPal is going to push this as far as they can. So,
yeah. Oh man. Well, I don't even know what to do with that. We're just kind of on it for the ride, for better or worse.
Pay the extra percent,
watch it and bitch and complain to PayPal if you want.
Yep.
Yeah.
Let's get some better news. Chad, let's bring up your SNC graded submission.
Yeah. So if you guys remember a few weeks ago, the infamous card show incident where I was placed in card court for reasons that the plaintiffs could not get on board with, whether it's because I submitted a Pokemon card or it's because I left Salt Lake City.
You faced multiple charges. That's normal. Uh-huh.
I think I'm still facing those charges now. But anyway, I was told that my GMAX Cuddle? I don't know. That it was going to come back in 3 weeks. And sure enough, right before the show aired, it came back in a nice little eBay envelope. So we're going to open it up right now and see what it's all about. Packaging, a little beat up from UPS. But it was within the 3 week realm of what I was told.
Yeah.
$15 a card.
We're such beaten people. Like, literally, that we're happy that it came back on time.
All right, see what we got here. And if I remember correctly, they don't do half grades. They're just whole grades. And that looking under the microscope, I thought I was going to guess it was a 9. But, I mean, I've never held a Pokemon card before.
Okay.
And the owner of the company thought it would be a 9 as well.
Okay.
Yeah, let's Pokemon cards have really thin borders. So when they're off-centered, it's super obvious. Yeah. So he's smiling.
Timmy. Chuckling.
Timmy. what is That's it?
It's a 10. It's a Gem Mint 10.
Nice.
VMAX 2021 Pokemon Sword and Shield. And then it's got the entire alphabet, which I guess is the card number. Shining Fate's Black Star promo holo. Like, you know what, guys? So, like, they put it in a plastic sleeve on the outside, which is a little beat up just because of the shipping method.
Sure.
But the case is pretty darn good quality. It's pretty sturdy. The logo, the label is a little crooked. But I don't know. What do you guys think? Looks like a pretty standard.
It's closer to, like, the thickness of an HGA slab than it is a PSA one, which would probably it be thinner next to it.
It kind of reminds me of those PSA DNA slabs you see that are blue. That's what it kind of reminds me of. But yeah, the card's sharp looking too.
And on the back, there's a little QR code. I suppose you could scan it. Maybe it'll tell you some information. So I don't know.
Maybe it'll give you a pop account again. Dude, is that a one of one?
One of one. Oh my God.
Get that on eBay.
Seriously. So let's see if this shows up here real quick as I scan the back of the card. Case looks pretty good. When I scan the photo, it just says SNC grading, and then I have to put in the serial number, which is 157 characters long, so we will not be doing that on this podcast.
All right.
So there you have it.
Well, that's another company, another experience.
Another one. Yep.
You're almost to the point that you could start a collection with all the different grading services.
We're going to crack that HGA. We are cracking my Donovan Mitchell HGA.
I think that's a mistake, unless you're going to resubmit it somewhere else.
I am.
Okay.
And I am. And I think to Beckett to try and get that gold label. Tim, do you still have your... No, I'm so transitioning a little bit into HGA. Tim, do you still have your Luis Robert?
Yes.
I want to buy it off you and crack it to practice. Okay. Okay?
Yeah. No, that's the least expensive card out of the group that we...
So, speaking of HGA... Tim broke the internet with this. Ricky, I don't know if you saw the video. Guys, I'm going to stay pretty neutral on what I say on this podcast about it.
You're Switzerland. Yep.
I am not.
I want to hear Ricky's
There are some listeners I was chatting with independently on Instagram. They know my feelings on this. But Tim, you found a video. HGA, I'll kind of tee this up a little bit. HGA put out a video of kind of their behind the scenes. I'm talking about their team from the front desk to the research department and kind of showed you each step of the way. They showed their graders. They showed their tissue boxes and their plastic chairs. They showed their customer service team. They showed their offices. And at the end, you get the Dunder Mifflin kind of Michael Scott production. Everyone's waving at the camera there at the end. Guys, it was
that wholesome. Was the most professional scene in the entire video, just so you know. I just want you guys to know that
it really jumped out to me that hey, we're a smaller company that's a community company that is trying really hard in this graded card market. However, when I have my really expensive cards, that is not what I am looking for in a company. But Tim, Tell us your thoughts on this and what led you to snap that photo. I guess, first of all, tell us about that photo, which you can find on our Instagram. But tell us about that photo and kind of briefly what your thoughts are.
Yeah, anybody who hasn't seen this video yet, just go to YouTube and literally Google or search behind the scenes at HGA.
Or hybrid grading approach behind the scenes is what I did.
Different ways to get there, but yeah. It should be the first one that pops up. It's dated June 28th. So by the time the episode airs this week, it'll have been a minute. But if you haven't watched it, you owe it to yourself to go watch it. Basically, they tried to pull the curtain back and do a little Wizard of Oz thing and show us behind the scenes what they were doing. And it is just horrendous. It's horrendous. I mean, I think the intention was fantastic, right? Like, we have begged PSA and Beckett to let us peek behind the scenes.
I don't want to see anymore.
Exactly. No, I mean, it would ruin it all. It would ruin it all if it's anything like this. But we wanted to know, and HGA showed us, and I think it completely backfired on them. I mean, like right now I'm paused at 39 seconds into the video and I'm staring at somebody's pot belly while he's fondling cards in a top loader.
No, Chad, don't give us that look. I'm going to tell you, I've never seen so many forearm tattoos in my life. I've never seen so many questionable whether or not they use soap in my life. You couldn't have told your employees one day to come in and dress business casual. this is not who I want to see grading my cards. I don't believe half the people on this video know what sports are. I am so disheartened. When you look at their professional graders, it looks like they're at almost like a nail spa doing nails. And I'm telling you, when I think of my PSA grader, I want my grader, like, I'll equate it to a driver, right? I want them to be the most nervous driver. I want their head up into the windshield, past the steering wheel. These guys are those 17-year-old punks you see driving. They've got the seat reclined as far back as they can. Their fingertips are touching the steering wheel. They could not give less of a crap about the cards they are looking at. I'm telling you, this video blows.
There's just so many funny things about the juxtaposition in this photo. I mean, like, the whole video's got its moments, right? But the specific moment I decided to screenshot, you've got a guy in a hoodie staring down at a desk. He's got maybe one card in his hand, so who knows, like, what he's actually doing. He's got a box of tissues, Kleenex, like, right next to him. Not microfiber cloth, tissues. Can you imagine what that's doing to surfaces? What he's been doing with the tissues, nobody wants to know. But he's sitting on an elementary-style plastic chair in flip-flops grading a card. Behind him, there's a guy in a gamer chair, so he probably knows nothing about sports, like you said. But at least he was smart enough to find a chair that's comfortable enough to sit on for all of 5 minutes during this video. And there's loose cables dangling from the ceiling.
There is, from the ceilings.
There's who knows what other kind of fire hazards all over the place. They're not even all facing the same way. It's just, yeah, it's not what you wanted to see. I mean.
Oh, Ricky's muted.
Yes,
Tim.
Yes. No, not on purpose. I wasn't muted on purpose. Yes.
Somebody else.
Yes. Yes. We did it, Tim. We did it.
I'm so flustered. No, but it just, like you pointed out at the very end, where they're all waving, the whole company, that, like I said, that's the most professional shot of the whole bunch. There's one point where, like, they hover like a camera phone over an image. It's just shot start to end awful. And unfortunately, I think this is probably what PSA, when I hear PSA saying or BGS ever saying, hey, we're adding employees, I worry that this is what we're getting.
And it's hard. The video quality is not what you want to show to card collectors with multi-$1,000 cards. I don't care who's sitting there. I don't care what they're wearing or what they got. You know, I'm fine with that. But it's not what you want to show. It's not. And Ricky, and I'm going to say this for you, Ricky. I know you're fired up and producing a bit, so I'm going to cover for you a little bit on that one. But yeah, it's not what you want to show.
No, yeah. And I agree with you. I was just going to say that, you know, if you're going to, for this kind of job, you got to have your employees comfortable. I get it. But I want to see bro dogs. I want to see them all in sports paraphernalia. I want to see the three of us up there grading cards. And that's just not what I'm seeing here.
Right. Someone hits a sick card that's a gem mint 10 and they jump up, high five each other in midair. And
yeah, exactly. That's cards. What I want. Yes. I want a good, like a Google style in work environment where people are rolling around on their floating devices, whatever it is, and high fiving each other. Cause they just found a gem mint 10.
We should start our own company. Oh,
but you know, the sad thing is for a company like HGA, I got to think that if the company, and you kind of saw it in their respective offices, the owners, I think HGA has gotten so popular. I don't think it matters. I think those owners have benefited greatly from that company so far.
I think they tried to show that they were kind of like a humble service. I hope. I don't know. I'm guessing.
That was the tone. I mean, yeah.
But again, I don't know. I think they still missed the mark.
Yeah, but they're still slabbing your cards. They're still protecting your cards. The slabs look cool. They're decorative. Yeah. They've got a little ways to come.
Yeah, they do. That Lamar Jackson background.
That
is pretty
looks
cool.
So cool. I thought, like, man, I almost want to go get that card just to submit it to them.
They still have that.
That's
Did you see how much paper they're wasting printing a single label?
Yes, I hope that was just for illustrative purposes.
I didn't even think about that. But yeah, I know exactly what you're saying.
It was like a 24 by 36 inch.
I'll tell you who's thinking about that. It's the guy sitting on the plastic chair. He's like, man, how much are we paying for this roll of paper that we're not using? Exactly. Why don't you buy me a little padding on the chair here?
Exactly. Oh, my God.
Couldn't afford a label maker.
Yeah. Well, and I liked that when they showed him packaging it, it was clear that they were like packaging it three different times.
Grading companies just can't really seem to get out of their own way. So lastly, guys, PSA. Are we good to move on to PSA?
Yeah, I was just going to say, this is why we'll never see what's at PSA or BGS. This segment here.
At the day of recording today, which is July 1st, this was supposed to be the day where PSA promised some sort of reopening for card submissions. There's been a pretty big fallout in the card ecosystem that we talked about. With PSA being gone, you know, card prices, the timing of it has also come down. So today, boys, you guys ready?
Yeah.
PSA has reopened Express level cards for $200 a card.
Yes.
That's $50 from previously. And that's it.
That's what we were waiting for.
Yes. Steve Sloan had a statement.
Okay.
Ricky, go ahead before I say it.
No, please share it because I think I'm going to comment on that.
Okay. A couple of things he said. Our objective with introducing Express at this new price is to manage demand while continuing to allocate the lion's share of our capacity to the existing backlog. During the past 3 months, we devoted 98% of our available capacity to the backlog. Even with the reintroduction of Express, 90% of our available capacity will still be applied to the backlog at this time. There's a couple other notes, but I'll pause there.
Yeah, that's why I'm okay with it. I'm okay with this with card. And I'm sure once I no longer have cards at PSA, I will not be okay with it any longer. But they need to get through this backlog. And I was kind of worried that they didn't give themselves enough time. And the fact that they are slowly opening this up. What was it before? Wasn't Express 300 before this? Or is it
Express 250? Was 150
or 150? Mm-hmm. Oh, so they've actually
Super Express was 300.
It. Super Express, okay, but they suspended Express, so now they've added Express to the Super. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
I'm cool with that. I'm cool with opening it that slow, especially that they're not mistreating their customers that are buying memberships. They're towing that membership until the cheapest comes back. I'm okay with that. I'm great the fact that they have 90% plus focused on that warehouse. That's what they need. And please, for the love of God, PSA, don't show us what's back there.
SGC did, and they did a fantastic job. So, I mean,
theirs look good.
Oh, really? I'll have to look it up.
Yeah. That's what we wanted to see. But yeah, no, I mean, PSA, I get it too, Ricky, right? Like, we don't want them to fall another 10 million cars behind, right? Realistically, this was all that they were going to announce today, you know, $200, right? That's still enough to keep people from submitting base. Like, right. They don't want that back. I could very easily see the next year being opened up being $100 and that's it, right? Like they don't want to be completely swamped with cards again. And so.
Yeah, no, totally.
Yeah.
I got another idea for how PSA To carry over kind of from our conversation a couple weeks ago with Chad, when he was 2 weeks ago with David, what if PSA did this? What if they allowed for a cheaper department and all you could do is they identified your card and slabbed it, okay? You get the same logo, no grade. But then you can then resubmit that slab and ask that it be graded for the additional rest of the price. PSA gets some money. They split up the work a little bit. Maybe it speeds it across when it's time to grade. Just sit there and chew on that for a minute. But
yeah, okay.
Okay. I don't know.
No, I can see pros and cons with it, right?
Right.
Beckett does a raw card review, which is not exactly what you're talking about.
Correct.
But it's something similar. It's a midway point. Keeps it somewhat stable. Keeps the card in good shape. I could see people forging those labels. They'd have to come up with something unique. so that people couldn't slap a grade on there. But that's an interesting thought.
I'm thinking like you pay, you know, even half the price, 3/4 of the price for the slab and the identification, and then you pay the last quarter for, and so everything else looks the same. Still the QR code on the back, still everything else. And then you maybe even have to repay for the new slab when it's time to resubmit it and grade it.
Yeah, you would. I think that would be cool if you wanted to keep, you know, Rick, you've joked about your OCD before with cards. This would help to get you to that goal, right? Of having everything uniform and look the same in a timely manner. That's an interesting thought.
And keep your cards safe while you're waiting to decide if this player is going to pan out or not. It might be a cheaper method that doesn't require a lot of man hours in that.
Yeah, that's where you get backlog though, right? That's where you get the investors who ship in thousands of cards, let them simmer or whatever we called it. Let them kind of marinate out there. And that can,
I'm just wondering
too,
if you take out the grading process, if you could get through those a little bit easier. You could, I almost wonder if you could use the AI for that kind of thing.
AI this week in cards, man. After watching that, you can't quite say that.
Apparently,
makes everyone pucker up just a little bit.
Yeah, and I'm referring more to, you know, taking a photo. Google will allow you to search a photo in their system. Maybe a system similar that will, you know, run them by and do that. I don't know. Just trying to think outside the box of ways that people can protect their cards and that it could still be prosperous for PSA. All right, it's been another fun show for Chad and Ben. I'm Ricky, the SNC, Gem Mint 10, G-Max Cuddle. Wishing all of you a wonderful night.
So, guys, I pulled up the QR code.
Yeah. Did you type
on
in the
SNC card? And I did put in this very long identification number.
Mm-hmm.
This is actually really cool. It pulls up subgrades.
Oh, that's cool.
Corners, 10, 9, edges, 10. Surface, centering, then the overall grade. So it got 3 10s and a 9.
Oh, wow.
That's cool.
Which is pretty cool. And then check this out. Right above it, there's a video of the grader reviewing my card.
Wow.
How cool is that?
Okay, see that? That's the kind of things I want to see. I want to see.
Isn't that awesome?
Hands covered in plastic, black plastic gloves. Don't show us their faces. Just show us the.
Yeah. Grading. You know, this video cut short, but the video was 45 seconds long. And I was watching it during the show. It looks really cool.
That's really cool. That's a really unique way. And I don't know how they're going to keep up with that if they grow, but that is super
There's
cool.
No pop count. True, right? There's no pop report on there, but that's pretty cool. I like that feature a lot, actually.
Oh, that's
PSA could do something similar, right? Because we always wonder what the subgrades are for PSA, right?
Right. Like,
they've got enough
money.
That
wouldn't take much.
They could just plug in a bunch of little...
They don't have to print it on the label. That's actually a really fantastic idea. Yeah. That's cool.
Very, very cool.
I may go back to them in the future.
No.